Welcome to this lecture 14, and in this lecture we are going to continue learning the Hamiltonian mechanism and Hamiltonian equation and Hamilton's equation of motion, which is an alternative to the Lagrangian. So far we have seen Newtonian, which you are very good at it, and you have solved so many problems using Newtonian mechanism. And then we went into Lagrangian, and then we now entering into Hamiltonian. Although these are different, you know, mechanism to approach a problem to be solved, but the physics is the same for a given problem, right? It is only based on how you look at the given problem to solve it. So the basic difference in all these mechanisms that we are seeing is Newtonian, Lagrangian and Hamiltonian is the viewpoint by which you can get the symmetries and cyclic coordinates, invariants, all of them are very transparent, so that you can solve the problem quickly by looking at all these conditions. Now, the Hamiltonian formalism is going to be quite inevitable for the so many options like Hamiltonian Jacob theory and quantum mechanics and this statistical mechanics, all subjects. And therefore, the Hamiltonian is mostly used for such subjects in detail. And of course, we are only going to look at in a very simplest part of it in this lecture to conclude the Hamiltonian mechanism as well. Okay, let's review what we did in the last class. That what we have seen is that by taking a Lagrangian in terms of generalized coordinate, generalized velocity and time dependent, we have written by using the chain rule dl by dt, which you can beautifully expand it in this form. And then by using the Lagrange's equation, we rearrange the term that is here into this format. And then we again rearrange it such that finally we end up in a term which is d by dt of summation over dj q dot j minus l plus partial derivative of l with respect to time equal to 0. This equation came where we defined the generalized momentum is nothing but the partial derivative of Lagrangian with respect to q dot j. Correct? And now we know that if the Lagrangian does not have an explicit time dependent, then we can write this part, the partial derivative of Lagrangian with respect to time is 0. So therefore, we can take out this term also to be 0. In such case, the d by dt of the term inside this bracket has to be 0. Obviously, we know a function, the derivative of a function to be 0 means the function is said to be constant. Correct? If the function is said to be constant here, then we have very clear explanation, so that the function, the summation over the partial derivative Lagrangian with respect to velocity coordinate and multiply by velocity coordinate minus Lagrangian is equal to constant. This is what we have seen in the last class, and thereby explaining the term that is within the bracket as the h, we introduce a new function called Hamiltonian equation, which could be explained in this functional form that you have seen here. Now, when I say Hamiltonian gives importance to the momentum process, momentum concept. Therefore, the q dot that we used in Lagrangian would be replaced with the concept of momentum all the time. So, it is written as Hamiltonian, generalized coordinate, generalized momentum and time. These three would be there. So your equation finally that you derive will not have any dot function. Say vx dot, y dot or y double dot. It will be in the term of px or py or p in simply. So therefore, when you write final term as a h, then we should ensure that your equation contains in the form of p, q and t, not in any other format. That is, you have to take care of it. For example, I'll show you a simple example. Although we did it in the last class, we again show it in a simplest way. If you consider a pendulum, and we know that Lagrangian of the system very clearly, which is nothing but half ml square theta dot square plus mgl cos theta. There's no difficulties. Now, in such case, now we are going to transfer this equation in the form of Hamiltonian, for which we need to see what are the generalized momentum, which is the partial derivative of Lagrangian with respect to q dot. Now, q dot, when you say it is a j is involved, depending on the number of generalized momentum corresponding to number of generalized coordinate. How many we have? We have only theta is the only one coordinate, because pendulum can be explained by variation of theta only. So theta is a generalized coordinate. Therefore, I will have only simply p theta as a generalized momentum. So which we can write it as a partial derivative of Lagrangian with respect to theta dot. So this is the Lagrangian given right now on the equation. So which will come to us as a m l square theta dot. Now, how do we define the Hamiltonian? Because we know the equation for Hamiltonian going to be written as pj q dot j minus l. Now we know what is pj. This is p theta. Now q dot j would be theta dot. So therefore we can write it. So let us write it. So p theta dot minus half ml square, this is your minus l. So both the term comes out to be minus. But remember, there are mix up between theta dot, p theta and again theta dot. We should rewrite everything in the p theta format. Now, since you know p theta is nothing but ml square theta dot, so I can write theta dot nothing but p theta by ml square. Correct? That's what we can rewrite it, and then we can substitute it here so that you are going to get the equation. So like that, theta dot is substituted by p theta by ml square. So I have minus this again substituted here will give us the term finally in the term of q, which is theta, p theta and t. You see, the functional form comes here eventually like this. I hope this is very clear for everyone, because you should take care and do not, you know, confuse writing in this functional form and looking for mark. This is not completed form. This is midway of the steps. The final form is written in this way, where you have only theta, p theta, t functional form. There are no theta dot involved for it. Please take care when you write Hamiltonian, because it is generalized coordinate and generalized momentum and time dependent, time involved, no other things. So that is how we have to write it. Now let us take simple more example, just like a projectile. So we know that this is in the zx plane. So therefore we can write the Lagrangian very straightforward in this case as m x dot square z dot square minus m g z, that is your potential energy, right? Now we are going to do the same thing step by step. You have to first find the generalized momentum, how many are here. Remember, here you have x dot, you have z dot. So therefore you have to be careful when you write it. So therefore pj can be, you will have px and as well as pz. And therefore we can find them from by taking the partial derivative of Lagrangian with respect to the corresponding velocity part. So therefore this will come as this way. So which we can write it as a x dot equal to px by m. Similarly on the right side, z dot equal to pz by m. So this is what you will get in both sides. Now we can write the functional form of the Hamiltonian. So you have q, p, q dot, everything is involved. So that is come out to be like this. Now by substituting the values, so you have two component. One is px x dot plus P z z dot minus of the Lagrangian, so that you have all the way that comes in here. So once you put in, then you know the value of Px here, and you just substitute, or x dot you can substitute it. So you are going to get it as something like this. So your x dot is replaced by Px by m, your z dot is replaced by Pz by m. So you can write it. So this is Px square by m, this is minus of Px square by m. So you will have plus of Px square by m, and so on. So this is what finally Hamiltonian comes in the form of it. So here you see again, although there is a generalized coordinate which is q, we can write this as x as well as z, but in this case there is no x component, whereas the momentum, you have both Px corresponding momentum Pz, and if there is a time it exists, otherwise it's not. So here there is no x component. So here also in this equation also there are no x component. So that is almost matching in a way of writing it. So instead of writing half mx square, it is written as px square by 2m. So this is how the other way of writing based on momentum concept. Okay, fine. Now we know how to write the Hamiltonian equation similar to Lagrangian equation. Correct? Lagrangian equation. Now, what would be the equation of motion similar to Lagrange's equation of motion? That we need to do that. So if you consider any system, any dynamical system at a given time t that can be described by a Lagrangian, then we say that the system evolve in time following the Lagrange's equation. So therefore we write this equation to get every equation of motion, each equation of motion for one generalized coordinate. So every generalized coordinate will have generalized coordinate. Generalized coordinate. So every generalized coordinate will have one equation of motion. This is what we understood. That means if you have n generalized coordinates in a given problem, will give you n number of equation of motion based on Lagrange's equation of motion derivation. That's very clear, right? No doubt about it. In the same way, if you consider a system which can be defined by or described by a function of Hamiltonian in this functional form, and if you want to evolve that system in time following a Hamilton's equation, what would be the Hamilton's equation of motion, or we call it Hamilton's equation motion? Would it be similar to what we derive for Lagrangian, or would it be different? And that's what we need to come to a conclusions. So how do we define the equations of motion based on Hamilton's mechanism? That's we are going to look at it. In order to do so, let us take the Hamiltonian expressed in the form of QPT and right side this one. Now let us take a derivative on the both side. So let me take dH as this is a partial derivative. So here d of the whole function come into picture. And you know very well how to take a partial derivative. So let us take only the left hand side, that this part dH of this side. What will be? Now it depends on the generalized coordinate, generalized momentum and time. So therefore you have to take a partial derivative. So that means dou h by dou qj and dqj and so on, which you know now very clearly to explain what should be in this form of it. So for qj, this is the partial derivative. For pj, this is the partial derivative. And for t, this is what stands. There is no difficulty here. Now let us do the same partial derivative for the right side part. So let's do the same for the right side part. So if you do the right side part, so you are having d of the whole term. So here two terms are there. Again, L contains Q, Q dot and T. Therefore, we need to do step by step. So let us first expand it so that this part separately, again this part separately. So what would be this part? This is d of xy. So we can keep x outside, dy minus y dx, or sorry, plus y dx. That's what we did here, keeping q dot j outside. This is dpj plus q, keeping pj outside, this is dq dot j. That's perfect. And similarly, Lagrangian can also be taken partial differentiation for q, q dot and t. So we have all the terms brought in. Now if we can rearrange these terms such that we can get a close correlation between left hand side and the right hand side, by which we can get the equations of motion for the Hamiltonian mechanism. Let's do how to do that. So what we got is, my left side is already defined, my right side is also already defined. Now I can look for certain rearrangement, obviously. So we can replace this term, which is partial derivative of L by Q, can be replaced by Lagrange's equation mechanism by this way. So either we can write it or we can equal to, so this is d by dt of partial L with the Q dot. This is nothing but generalized momentum, and this is also a generalized moment. This term also represents a generalized momentum. So this can be write P dot here. So let us put it up carefully. So now this term is simply the same. This is also same, no change. And here, because it's d by dt of Pj, I can write it as P dot j. So therefore this term has come, and dqj is as it is. Here this is again generalized momentum, so pj dq dot j minus this term as it is without any change. Now can you see in this term anything common? This is dqj, this is dpj, not possible, but there is a dq dot and dq dot. So this is in plus term and this is in minus term, so we can cancel each other. So obviously take out these two terms from this list, so we will end up in having three terms. So you are going to have my left side, which is given in purple color, my right side given in this one. So this relationship for the, you know, any arbitrary value would be true for dpj, dqj and dt. Now since you have left side three terms, right side three terms having similar format, can we compare it? For example, if I take this term, I have dpj. Where is dpj here? For example, here. So we can compare with this term and you will get a relationship. Since these two are same, can we not say q dot j is nothing but the partial derivative of Hamiltonian with respect to dpj? Similarly, if you look at this term, here you have dqj, here also you have dqj. So we can compare this as well as this term. So let us say this is 1 and this is 1 and this is my second term and here is my second term. So what will come? My p dot j is nothing but minus of partial derivative of Hamiltonian with respect to qj. And obviously I have the third term here and here also a third term, which says the partial derivative of Hamiltonian with respect to time is nothing but minus of partial derivative of Lagrangian with the time. So what eventually you are going to get as this three functional form of it. One is p dot j, which is nothing but minus of partial derivative of h by dou qj. Q dot j equal to partial derivative of Hamiltonian with respect to momentum. And this is the partial derivative of Hamiltonian with time is nothing but minus of partial derivative of Lagrangian with time. These are called Hamilton's equations. Now you see, there are three equations for each generalized coordinate. But in other words, in general, when we say time independent situations, we have generally Hamilton canonical equation as, one is p dot j, other one is q dot j. That means for every generalized coordinates, or if you have a system having n degrees of freedom, say 1, 2, 3, then For each coordinate, each degree of freedom, you will have two first order Hamilton's equation, and therefore if your system has n degree of freedom, then you will end up in 2n number of first order Hamilton's equation. I hope this is very clear. And if you compare with the Lagrangian, and you know very well, Lagrangian equations are often second order differential equation, and the number of equations are only n. Here it is 2n, here it is n. We will see few examples, so make it very clear. Obviously, if you look at it, it's only mathematics and the concepts are rearranged. There's nothing new that to discuss about the physics of it, because it's only concept varying. However, the Hamiltonian concept is going to be extremely important for quantum mechanics, quantum statistical mechanics, and so on, which you would learn in more in detail depending on the course that you continue on it. Okay, so keeping that, let's now move on with next level. Okay, conservation of energy from Hamiltonian. Already somebody posed question, not a worry, I will explain it here. So how are we going to prove it? So let's start from the typical Hamiltonian equation. H is defined as H Q P J T. Shall we take the chain rule form by taking a partial derivative? We can write it dH by dt is this way. One is for the Q term, other one is for the P term and the time term. It turns out to be there is no difficulties. So what is the dou H by dou Q J? Just now we discussed. It is nothing but minus P dot J. Similarly, this one is Q dot. So can we just substitute this one? So this term is minus P dot J. DQJ by DT is Q dot. Similarly, this term is Q dot J and this is P dot. Now you see these are equal and opposite, and therefore they can cancel each other. This is what we explained it, so that you can cancel it by saying the differentiation of normal differentiation of Hamiltonian with respect to time is same as the partial differentiation of Hamiltonian with respect to time, which means if Lagrangian does not explicitly contain time, then Hamiltonian also will not have a time dependence, which means I can write it, if partial derivative of L with respect to time is nothing but minus partial derivative of H by T, if this is going to be 0, so this also going to be 0, which means if this is going to be 0, my H has to be constant of motion. Now the question comes, what is H? Is it something related? Is it something called total energy? And that's what would be the question in your mind, right? How do we conclude it? Okay, if we take system, something related to having a potential which is velocity independent, then we can rewrite this term beautifully, that sigma pj q dot j is nothing but this is generalized momentum. So therefore, we are going to write it partial derivative of L with respect to Q dot and Q dot. Now, once you say potential is velocity independent, that means the term partial derivative of U with respect to Q dot would be 0. So therefore, if I use L, which is equal to T minus U, so therefore, the partial derivative of L with respect to Q dot can be represented by dou T by dou Q dot minus dou U by dou Q dot. So this is 0. So therefore, my L turns out to be simply in functional form of T. Now you know what is this term? This term is nothing but Euler function. Euler equation, which will eventually give you us 2t in the case of the problem that we are discussing for a free particle, if the t is a function of the order of 2 degree of order. This we have already explained it. So if that is true, then my Hamiltonian is going to be written in this form. So this term now is 2t, and L is t minus v or u, whatever we can write it, and therefore you can put t plus v, which is energy, which has to be constant. So if H does not explicit time dependent, if H does not explicit time dependent and the potential in the problem is velocity independent, then we can say so. This is what somebody raised it. So this is where proof you have. So conservation of energy from Hamiltonian is also true, provided these conditions are taken into account. In the same manner, you also have a cyclic path. Because what we say cyclic, if a coordinate does not exist in a given Lagrangian, we can say that that coordinate is a cyclic coordinate. This is what we return it. So this statemently, if a particular coordinate does not appear in L, the coordinate we said to be cyclic coordinate. In such case, we also say that, so for example, if Qj is cyclic in L, which means it does not exist, then it will also true for cyclic in Hamiltonian. So if you write it, and if Qj does not exist, so it is true for both the side of it. Because Q dot is different. Q is different. They are independent coordinates. So therefore, it is cyclic for that. But then we say that corresponding generalized momentum to that cyclic coordinate should also be zero. So therefore, this is what we say, partial derivative of Hamiltonian with respect to Q is going to be zero, which means if this is zero, what we say, this is a P dot J, we defined as minus partial derivative of Hamiltonian with the Qj, and we are saying this is zero means the derivative, the differentiation of momentum is going to be zero, which means the Pj stands out to be constant. Okay, so therefore, this is what comes out to be. A question is raised. I will answer it later. Please keep that question ready. So, the generalized momentum here can be again observed very quickly, similar to Lagrangian, which may not be straightforward in Newtonian mechanism. Okay, with that, let us try to solve a few examples so that you are clear in procedures to be followed and you can, you know, solve the problem. I know the tutorial 6, the last problem, 7th one that you solve is how to involve the Hamilton equation of motion, which I have not expressed, so you can now use it. So we are considering a frictionless harmonic oscillator, and that's what we derived it, right? Consisting of your mass M, you would have got answer A Q dot square by 2. A is actually mass to be considered. This is what it would have been discussed in your last tutorial. But anyway, that's not important in this problem. M on a spring constant K, obtain the Hamiltonian, evaluate the canonical equation and solve for the position as a function of time. And then we can also correlate between what came up with the Lagrange's equation and what is coming up from the Hamiltonian equation. Do they have the same physical meaning? Let's try to get it. So you obviously first write what is the functional form of Hamilton equation. So you write it, and now you look at how many generalized coordinates are here. You have only one, x is the generalized. So therefore, this even j is meaningless. So we can straight away write it. And we know what is the equation of motion for this condition. One is px, one or p dot, just simply minus dou h by dou x. Similarly, x dot is dou h by dou p. But we need to find first Hamiltonian for it, for which we need to first get p. P is the partial derivative of Lagrangian with respect to x dot. So we can write here, this is the m x dot, or we can write x dot as p by m. Now remember, we also need to find x dot from the Hamiltonian. Would it be the same as this one? Right? You have a question here. And if it is, do we need to separately find or I can directly get it from here? So that is also a question. Okay, we will come out. So the Hamiltonian is p x dot, so m x dot minus Lagrangian half m x dot square plus half k x square. So this is plus 1, this is minus half term, so it will be plus half term. So we are going to get it as plus half m x dot square plus k x square. So replace the x dot, because we are not going to write x dot term, rather we are going to use the p term. So x dot can be written in the form of p by m, correct? So if that is the case, so x dot will be replaced by p square by m square, will give you p square by 2m plus half k x square. Now we have come to the standard form of equation. This is the Hamilton's equation, not motion. Now we have to find the equation of motion. So first is p dot. So let us take the partial derivative of h with respect to x with the minus term involved. So if you do that, so minus dou h by dou x. So here only x term is here. So it will be minus kx. You know what is minus kx? This is nothing but force. So I can write simply f. Let it be right now. The second is x dot. X dot would be the partial derivative of h with respect to p. So let us write it. So partial derivative of h with respect to p. So if you take it, 2 cancel. So p by m. Am I getting this one and this one same? Yes, it is to be. So for a given problem, whether you approach Lagrangian or the Hamiltonian, the coordinate velocity component more or less could be the same. Now, what did we get from the Lagrange's equation? If I go back, I get the Lagrange's equation as mx double dot plus kx equal to 0 for the same problem if I use this functional formation to do that. That means when we implemented d by dt of partial derivative of dou l by dou x dot minus this as 0, when this mechanism introduced, we got the equation to be like this. Are we seeing these and these are same? Yes, it is. What is here? It is p dot. What is p dot? I don't have directly p dot, but p is here. So I can get p dot, which is nothing but m x double dot. So what is p dot turn out to be? Which is minus kx. So I can rewrite it as m x double dot plus kx equal to 0, which is the same equation that you are getting here. So what it says is that finally, whether approach can be different, but the solution for a given problem cannot be different. The physics is simply the same. That's what ending up. So let's look at another simple problem, the bead motion. So we know the Lagrangian, we have explained it to be like this. Now, depending on where you consider, the potential energy can be plus or minus. So that is a simple difference. That's anyway, we'll vary it. You have to clearly say it. Now we follow the same mechanism. Let's take. Now we have here, carefully you look at it, what are the coordinates? How many independent coordinates, generalized coordinate? So you again have only theta, if I remember. So theta is good enough to explain the system. So again, you will have only two equations, which can be p dot and theta dot. Now let's find p from the Lagrangian by using the standard form, that is partial derivative of Lagrangian with respect to theta dot. So since only theta dot term is here, so it is m a square theta dot, giving you theta dot equal to p by m a square, right? Very clear. Now we are going to put it in the form of Hamiltonian and write it. So m a square theta dot, which is p, and theta dot, which you have to multiply, minus this is Lagrangian. So this is plus 1, this is minus half. So we will get minus term. So minus m a square theta dot square minus a square omega, all this term comes in. But this is not final term, because you have theta dot, which has to be brought in the form of momentum. So substitute theta dot with the p by m a square. So your equation will eventually turn out to be p square by m a square minus half this particular term minus the potential term. Hope this is clear. Now we got the Hamiltonian that you need to be derived in the form of theta, p and t. Now we need to get these two terms as an equation of motion. Now, if you write it, the p dot here, we're taking minus partial derivative of h with the theta. So you have theta term here. So this is sine square theta. Eventually, will give 2 sine theta cos theta. So therefore, 2 gets cancelled and this minus. So there will be plus. So it's plus term comes. Here cos theta, so it will be minus sine theta, so it will be plus. Again, when minus term comes, it is MGS sine theta. So I got a term, that's P theta. Now what would be theta dot? Theta dot is the partial derivative of Hamiltonian with the momentum. So give you the P by MA square. Now you see this theta dot and this theta dot are the same for this problem. Now what is the Lagrange's equation? Do I get the same way of correlation? The Lagrange's equation comes out to be for this in the given problem that you solved earlier is come out to be like this. So you can see my right side term that you see here are the same. There is no difficulty. But here it is P dot. You know what is P? So P dot, this equation gives you P dot as M A square. These are all constant. Therefore, this is theta double dot. So do you see theta double dot ma square is here? So therefore, again, it brings the same information. So no difference. Now let's take one more complicated example to give you the same flavor or not, right? Because we are only seeing a single or a generalized coordinate. Let us take two generalized coordinate and try to adapt it. So here, this problem again, we saw it is given in the solution. So for this, Lagrangian is here. So this is your R and this is your Z. So the R plus Z in this case will be simply the L, total length of the string is fixed. So obviously you can write this as a, you know, R dot plus Z dot equal to zero, or R dot will be is also Z dot. So that's why this R dot square is placed in place of Z dot square. So this anyway you solve it. Now, we write, so always I suggestion is that go step by step. Do not rush it, then you end up in mistake and easy to confuse it. And now here you carefully do that. So we have, this is the equation of motion and there are two generalized coordinate. One is R, another one is theta. So therefore, you will have actually four set of equations, right? Four equations for R2 and theta 2 should be there. Let's look at one by one how to solve it. So the Hamiltonian will be finally can be written because here it's a summation of terms. So you have PR R dot and P theta theta dot. And we know what is PR dot, that is partial derivative of Lagrangian with respect to R dot. P theta is partial derivative of Lagrangian with respect to theta dot. Let us find that and then come back one by one. So PR is partial derivative of Lagrangian with R dot. So R dot is here, R dot is here. So you have M plus M R dot, which eventually give you the R dot relationship as a PR by M plus M. Similarly, we take for theta, P theta. This is theta is dou L by dou theta dot. So it's only here. So M R square theta dot. Again, theta dot comes out to be P theta by M square, M R square. We already got two Hamilton's equation of motion. Now this should be same as finally what we are getting to confirm it. So we let us substitute this one in this equation to bring the Hamiltonian. So this is QPJ. So PR is here, M plus M R dot. So we are writing M plus M R dot plus MR square theta dot minus the whole Lagrangian. So we can write minus this term, so all terms are written. So we can separate it out, this is M R dot square plus M R dot square, here also M is there. So let us rearrange it carefully. So this is what, you can expand this term. Now look at one by one term, so these two are same. So this is plus 1 minus half. Similarly, we have these two term, plus 1 minus half. And finally, this also plus 1 and minus half. So we can bring it to be all plus half by simple mathematics. So m by 2 r dot square plus m by 2 small r dot square plus m by 2 r square theta dot square minus potential energy. But here again r dot theta dot exists. So this is not enough. So we need to rewrite this equation carefully. So when you rewrite it, so we can bring all the terms together to be uniform. So r dot square is taken commonly. Now replace r dot by this equation and theta dot by this equation. What we are going to get eventually is, when we substitute, this is what comes. So r dot square is pr by m plus m. So the m plus m cancels. So pr square by 2m plus m. And this is p theta square by 2mr square minus mgl minus r. Got the final form, right? Now, is it giving the same meaning? We need to carefully evaluate. So let us first find out p dot r. First one for corresponding to r. So p dot r means you have the derivative of minus partial derivative of h with respect to r. So here r is there, so it will be p theta square minus, and minus minus cancel, so mr cube, this minus mg r gets cancelled. So this is what comes out. Now what is p theta? That is mr square theta dot. So I can substitute here, so it all cancels, will give similarly, we can get r dot, sorry, with that, which is partial derivative of h with respect to pr. So we take out this term, so which is pr by m plus m. Now you can see this term also matching with this term. So there's no problem. Now the equation of motion that we written by Euler-Lagrange equation for r dot turn out to be this functional form. So you have m plus m r double dot equal to mr theta dot square minus mg. You see that equation? You see here my right side is almost matching with what I have on my right side. But the left side is, now it is written as pr dot, for which you know what is pr, m plus m r dot. So pr dot would be m plus m r double dot. So combining these two Hamiltonian equation, you are bringing one of the Lagrangian equation correct. Now we have one more theta component. Let us solve step by step. So p theta dot would be minus the partial derivative of h with respect to theta. Now there is no theta component here, so it is turned out to be zero. Similarly, theta dot here is the partial derivative of Hamiltonian with respect to p theta. So you have p theta component, so 2 p theta by mr square. But what Euler-Lagrangian equation said, this term is going to be constant. Do we have the same meaning here? Because if p theta dot is tending to 0, what it means? So I can say p theta is equal to constant, which is very clear. What is p theta? Which is nothing but m r square theta dot. From here, m r square theta dot. So I have the same physical meaning of the statement. I'm sure I'm convincing it very clearly, and it is made very clear for you to understand it. So when you have more than one generalized coordinate, please go step by step, ensure that you are adapting properly both the terms in Hamiltonian. By chance, if you miss one of them, your Hamiltonian will be eventually wrong. This equation will be wrong. Sorry. This equation will eventually turn out to be wrong. If this is wrong, every other parameter will turn out to be wrong. So you will end up in consequences process. So therefore, check whether your system has how many degrees of freedom, generalized coordinate, and carefully write the Hamiltonian accordingly. And then you get for corresponding Hamilton equations of motion, which has to be 2n compared to, this is for Hamilton, Lagrangian is only n number of equation of motion. That is second order derivative here. This is only first order equation in the Hamilton. So these are the difference that you have to take care. And now by you can solve that equation, sorry, the problem 7 also here, and it is very good. Okay, so the questions posed are, is it only the H is simply total energy? Not necessarily to be always the truth. So we have already explained why it is, under what condition it will be H equal to total energy. So we have explained it. So you have to consider those only under those circumstances, it would be H equal to T plus U, which is total energy, which is constant. Otherwise, it isn't. So you have to be careful. One is explicit time and velocity should be independent of, potential should be independent of velocity component. So these two have to be there to say Hamiltonian as a total energy. Otherwise, there can be a situation where, can you say in this Hamiltonian that what we have written in this bracket, so you can see here, I'm just circling, squaring it. Do you see any time component here? Can you say Hamiltonian here is a constant, conserved quantity? So that's what you have to carefully deal with. So it all varies. So with that, we have come to the end of classical mechanics, and up to this, your mid-semester syllabus covered. So up to 14 lectures, you have the syllabus for mid-sem. And now we have done our part. Now your part is very important. What is your part? We have demonstrated you a new mechanism of dealing, right? Starting from Newtonian to Lagrangian and then going into Hamilton's and so on to solve the same problem depending on the situation. Now, since, and we also introduced the new coordinates other than Cartesian, we have done polar coordinates, we have done the cylindrical polar, spherical polar coordinates. So therefore, you have learned something new, and then you can now quantify whether we really make you like it or even more love it, or you are happy with it, or I'm yay with it, or you are, wow, that's something new come up, or you are just said, sorry sir, mujhe to I had difficulty, so I'm sad or angry. Please, you know, make yourself comfortable in giving your feedback, which is, you know, good for us to improve. Because this is a pandemic, obviously, you know, there are a lot of things different than taking a, you know, normal class that we would have otherwise meet physically, reading your mind and reading your face, and then, you know, go back one step and so on. And so on. But otherwise, what we did, please let us know based on your feedback, and you make your feedback so that we can improve ourselves for betterment. This pandemic continues. Your juniors also going to suffer the same. At least those suggestions we can take into account, move forward for betterment of that. So with those points, we will close this session and come to your question and answer. If you have any questions, let's try to answer.